Hi, everyone. This is Angel Borrelli, and welcome to The Fix, Season 8, Episode 4. And I am so glad to be back with all of you. And I just found out from my editor this morning that it's actually been 6 weeks since my last podcast. Actually, I sound like a little Catholic girl doing a confession here. That's what I feel like. I felt so bad when I saw it was 6 weeks. But hey, everyone, that was a perfect off season and I needed it. You know, I work in the trenches. I'm not just a scientist that sits in the office and does research. And the last few weeks with everyone departing and having to report at a different date was grueling. But I'll tell you, this last year has been amazing. And I have learned so much by having my guys with me for longer. And what I really want to say to all of you is thank you for continuing to call me and write me during that 6 weeks hiatus. And actually about a week and a half ago, it exploded. I was getting emails and calls. And of course, you're asking me the most interesting questions. And today I wanted to be sure and touch on some of the topics that I think came up the most. And it's so funny. There's so many topics to discuss, but there's always a few that come up more than others. And I've been getting a lot of calls from pitchers this year. And so in the last few weeks, pitchers starting their season and having some issues come up. So I'm so happy that you all actually rattled my chain and got me back into it. And of course, to open the season back up, I had to have my favorite guest host, Larry Owens. Hey, Larry.
Hey, Angel. Thanks for having me. Great to be back.
And I appreciate it because I know you're in season and I know that what's on your plate. So I appreciate your taking the time to do this with me.
No problem. Absolutely. It's a pleasure.
Yes. So, and Larry, I wanted to say something and just get your thought on this because I know you were a minor league pitching coach. So I just saw that there is a specific team, a good team. They have 8 pitchers on their DL.
Oof.
Since the beginning of the season.
Not good.
And they happen to be, I believe, mostly out of the pen. And I thought, you know, so I'm getting more calls from pitchers than I ever have. Mostly I have tons of pitchers that listen to me, but they just don't pick up the phone and call. Coaches call me. Fathers call me. But this year, I've had pitchers that I don't know that have written to me and said they're a huge fan of the podcast and they've been listening for years. And they're asking me about it's always because they have some pain. And this is the first year I can say it's been in an inordinate amount. What do you think is happening in the major leagues? Are they using their pen? I mean, I noticed that there's a lot of pitchers being pulled and rotated. Do you think it has something to do with the amount of innings they're getting, or what's your thought on that?
I don't know. I haven't watched any of it. You're talking about in the big leagues?
Yes.
Yeah, I really haven't watched and I haven't been able to pay attention to a whole heck of a lot of it, but I do know that the way the bullpens are being used, the way pitchers are being used anymore, you saw it recently where, I mean, I guess it was a no hitter in the big leagues, which obviously requires you to throw a complete game. And then, you know, there was another, I think, complete game shutout. I think they were maybe back-to-back days or really close. And so the past few years, you know, they weren't going to let anybody face, especially saw in the playoffs, they wouldn't let you face a hitter 3 times. And then they'd go straight to the bullpen, which in my opinion, you know, blows your bullpen up over the long haul. And I understand why they want to do it. I get it, but yeah, that could be the reason. Are they not letting, you know, our starters not getting, you know, through 6 or 7 innings. And then you got to cover, If you're on the road, you got to cover 4 to win. If you're at home, you got to cover 4 just to finish the game. You know, that's a lot of innings to cover, you know, night after night. So it could just be how they're using them. In my opinion, if you use them like that, I think they're going to, you know, you're going to have some guys break down. You can't, you know, to me, the starting pitcher's job is to throw 6 innings. At least that's your job. You need to throw at least 6 innings. You should be equipped to do that. And if you're not equipped to do that, if you're not capable of doing that, then to play 162 games over, you know, a big league season, that's a lot of innings for your bullpen to cover. And so then I think, and you can go back and I've done some research on it. You can go back and we've used more pitchers in the big leagues. It's gone up, continue to go up year after year. Guys are shuttling back and forth from the big leagues to AAA and guys are getting used. Relievers, in my opinion, are getting overused in the big leagues, generally speaking. And that could be why, but I couldn't say exactly. That's just my observation of, you know, how they're using the analytics to navigate a game, and they're not letting starting pitchers face hitters three times. And they should be good enough to do that, I think.
Yes. Well, you know, there's two sides of the equation that, you know, whenever something, there's a trend, it's important for me to notice. And because, you know, I'm mostly with guys that I'm hoping end up there one day, they're on their road there. And when you see something, a trend, regardless if you like it or not, if it is a trend and it is what's happening, and this is one of the best teams in baseball, actually, it's the Tampa Bay Rays. Okay. 8 guys as of this morning. We know they do a lot of stuff right. My hat's off to them. And I've known about that team for years because I met some of their staff. Years and years ago, I met some of their PTs and the athletic trainers, and I felt they were, you know, really some of the best. So they actually do a good job. When you see this happening, so for the work I do, when I see a trend in baseball, and this is important for all of us, especially coaches, where we're working with high school kids and college kids, and we know we're trying to move them up the ladder. When there's a trend going on, you've got to kind of look at it. You've got to say, well, if they're going to do this with my closers, what do we need to do? So, you know, one closer a game, maybe one middle relief guy, probably don't have to change much. But if we're starting to get closers that are going in more than once in every 3 days, then they need to probably be training differently in their bullpens. So I'm hoping that if this trend continues, they start to see, because the stresses that the injuries they had were, again, always mostly, in fact, I don't think I saw one shoulder injury, maybe one. The rest were forearm, elbow. One's out for surgery. I mean, and this all happened, what, we're into the season by, what, 3 weeks now? And of course, there were preseason games. But I think when we start to see a trend of injuries like this, but we were wondering why, because pitchers, if the relievers are going in, then the starters aren't pitching as much. But if we're still seeing a lot of injuries, I mean, it's not a matter of who's getting injured. We don't want to have this many injuries. That's an inordinate amount. So matching the training, matching what we do to what we see as trends, because trends trickle down. And I know if I'm sending a guy and he's in the minor league system, and let's say he's a closer, I'm going to be sure that he's conditioned to be able to handle what looks like the new workload of the relievers, especially right now with the relievers. And they're talking about this a lot. They're talking about that, you know, there's a lot of relievers going in more in a game than ever before. And I don't know if that's true because there's only a few teams that I watch, but an interesting factor. I just wanted to get your take on it. And I love something you said, and you said this to me the other day, and I think this is so important, you know, because especially when we're dealing with younger kids, just like if your son gets a job, you say to him, you be on time for work. You know, you dress accordingly. You listen to your boss. You know, no, you don't go in late. We give them rules. We learn them to respect. And you said on the phone to me the other day, and you just said it, the job of a pitcher is to get through 6 innings. I think that is one of the best things I've ever heard you say. I think pitchers have to understand what their role is and to give them as a goal, not just, you know, oh, well, this time I'll throw 4 or whatever. I mean, they always want to stay in. But I think when you frame it, there was something about the way you framed it when you said your job. And I think pitchers have to start to get, I don't care if you're in high school or you're in 8th grade, this is your job. You decided you wanted the ball. You decided you wanted to go on the mound. So now, along with that, there's certain things you have to do. You have to be conditioned. You have to sleep the night before. You got to eat right, because your job is to get up and do your job. Because if you don't, it ends up trickling down on the rest of the team. So I love that you said that. And that's totally out of the mouth of what I would expect from you as a great head coach. You say some interesting things there. The nuances are what's interesting. So anyway, so welcome back to the show. So let's get started. So when I, at this time of the year, I get tons of calls from coaches that are asking me about certain issues and that are going on. And you always have to deal differently in season with troubleshooting issues because you don't want to reinvent the wheel. As much as sometimes competition does show up a weakness, sometimes you have to earmark the changes for when the pitcher is not in season. So what I would like to do today is talk about two things that I think are really important to do and ways to kind of solve them that can get you out of most problems with pitchers. So the first thing I want to talk about, and I've mentioned this before, when you have and the pitchers that are good that start to go bad, this is when you want to utilize some of the tips I'm going to give you today as a troubleshooter. Because when someone sends me a video in season, there may be a million things that I could see or talk about, but I'm going to pick the thing that's going to give the pitcher the most information and also is maybe the easiest thing to fix and also the one thing that might fix a bunch of other stuff. So when you have a pitcher that's going bad, what do I mean by that? He tells you his arm's starting to hurt. He's not throwing strikes. You see the ball coming out of his hand funny. He looks like he's pushing the ball. You can't quite get your arm around it because basically he looks like the same pitcher. The thing that you want to do is you want to go behind the plate, just like you're the umpire, and you in a bullpen or in one of your scrimmages, and you want to look. And if you're filming, what you want to do is stop at the moment when he's at max external rotation. Max external rotation is the point where the ball's lined up and he's ready to throw. And it's the point at which he's going to start moving the ball forward. He has now kept it behind him and now it's coming forward. Stop the camera right there. Be precise about the moment. And I want you to look to see if his hips, and when I say hips, I mean pelvis, are facing the hitter. Very frequently, the problem that happens is, and we'll talk about the cause of this, the pitcher does not get his body square to the plate. You have to be facing the direction of your target. The motion is designed to go from sideways to facing the hitter. And he rotates in between. He goes sideways. He steps out. He turns his body. And then he throws the ball. He's turning the body to get the ball ready to throw. And then when he throws it, hopefully he's throwing it consistently, and that's how he gets the location of the pitch. It's also the way that if he's using his body, that he gets velocity. So let's say you've got someone, velocity's dropping, location's dropping. You want to get behind the plate and see, are his hips facing forward? When I say the hips, I mean, so if you put your hands in your two pockets, if you have jeans on, that big square rectangular bone that goes from right to left is your pelvis. It's not part of your legs. It's a separate entity. Look it up in an anatomy book if you're not sure. It's not a flat bone, but we're going to call it that. So you just kind of see two legs coming up, and then you see this rectangular big bone that's in there, and the pockets are laying over the sides of those bones, or right in the front, rather. That's your pelvis. That is what begins rotation. What happens is a pitcher, because of all that's happening, sometimes gets a little bit delayed with the back leg and he's doing something weird. And the back leg is a very important leg. The back foot's very important. But if that pelvis isn't square, then you're going to have a trunk. When he delivers the ball, as he starts to come forward, if you see his pelvis, if he's a righty, if he's a righty, he's going to be facing to the left of the plate. He'll be facing the third baseline or into that dugout that's by the third baseline with the right side of his pelvis. If he's a lefty, his hip will be facing probably first base or that dugout that's right there, but you will not see. It would be like that pocket that on that side is dangling and angling to the side. But his body will be square. The other error you might see is that his trunk isn't even square, that his hips are facing off and his trunk is also facing off. So you're always going to see the pelvis not being square, but maybe the trunk is, or you're going to see the pelvis and the trunk not being square, which I can tell you is a very bad situation. But in both scenarios, if the hips are not clearing, meaning squaring easily, that means one, the pitcher's rotation was off, therefore his velocity will be off. The other thing is, the pitcher is not square, therefore his arm got ahead of his body. And because when that happens, the shoulder is late to the game, he will have to lead with his elbow to get the arm through. And when you lead with the elbow, and let's say you're not used to leading with it, you're going to get weird forearm pain. You might have front shoulder pain, but you're definitely going to have pitches that aren't locating because your arm didn't come through correctly. So in season, one of the best things you can do when any pitcher has any problem, particularly if he's one of your guys and you're not used to seeing this, something has gone wrong, first go behind the plate and look to see if either one of those errors is occurring. And I want to check with you, Larry, on this before I say what would be the cause of this, which would be the thing you would go to adjust. And it's simple. So far, am I explaining the direction stuff, Larry, and making it clear?
No, absolutely. Very clear.
Okay, yep, cool. Okay, cool. So why would this happen? Why would a pitcher not, let's talk about the pelvis. Now, if the pelvis doesn't act right, the trunk therefore can act right sometimes, but you won't have velocity. But if both aren't acting right, you really got to solve the problem. But the reason that causes the hips not to clear, and when I say clear, in a right-handed pitcher, the left pelvis is moving over the left leg, the right pelvis is squaring up. Okay, so you're like turning a wheel. If the front foot has landed too, for a righty, his front foot would be landing too far to the right. For a lefty, his front foot would be landing too far to the left. Am I saying that right? Yeah, right hand, right leg. So if the leg, so this would be what you guys call throwing across the body kind of look. If the front leg is way over, then the hips aren't going to be able to clear. So the first simple thing you do while you are behind the plate looking is, first, he's not square. Second, is his foot allowing him or disallowing him to get square? So before you start going through gyrations, and let's say this is a guy who has been throwing across his body, but he's really bad. When you're doing something incorrectly, and Larry, I was just saying this to you today, there's a lot of great pitchers that do things that aren't kinesiologically sound. And it makes us bang our head against the wall. But you know what? If you practice something enough, you can become good at it. Because practice, even if you're doing something wrong, you can be good. But when you're not efficient, meaning you're pushing the body to do things that aren't actually what it loves to do, you can invite a breakdown. So let's say the guy's just upset one day. Now he's got an inefficient motion. And let's say it's just that he's mentally not right. Well, he might not get away with that error. So on that day, when you're looking and you see this, move that foot, mark the mound and say, you know what? I want you to look down, step here and let's pitch. And then you look again and you do your filming and you see, yes, now he's square. And so then that's the issue to work with. So one reason why a pitcher may not be square to the plate, which means inefficient rotation and inefficient bringing the arm through, look for the foot placement. Let's say he places his foot correctly, but he didn't get the backside of his pelvis around. He didn't get the arm side of the pelvis around. It didn't turn all the way. The steering wheel did not turn completely. The back foot and the back leg are responsible to assist the pelvis in its rotation. The pelvis itself has different muscles on it that can help rotate it. But the back leg, remember, he's only got that leg on the ground. And when he strides out, it's in that stride that an error will occur that affects the way he's going to turn his body. So anytime we have a rotational problem, we have to look at, well, where does everything start? And it starts with the back leg. In fact, I can just tell you guys this, 99.9% of all troubleshooting problems occur before the front foot lands, because that back leg is controlling direction, it's controlling timing, it's controlling so many different things. But in this situation, what you're going to do if he's not square is you're going to go to the side and you're going to start to watch, how does he use his back leg? So the way the back leg is used, it starts with the foot. He's next to the rubber. The hips are going to be shifted forward. That's your weight shift. It's just like in golf, a golfer shifts his weight. It's just like in hitting, he shifts his weight. Now, what they do next is different in all the three skills, but you shift your body weight forward. And a pitcher has to do that by connecting the back foot to the ground, moving out sideways, and then he's putting pressure down into the foot, and specifically the ball. It's called a ball because it rolls, and he's got pressure into the ball of the foot, and that turns towards the plate, and it is turning and giving the pressure to the hip and the ankle, and now we've got the leg that's in between turning, and the hamstrings of the leg are assisting in rotating that leg, which assists in rotating the pelvis. So if you've got a weird back leg, let's say you drop it all the way to the ground. Let's say you, and I saw this from a coach that called in with an error, and it happened to end up being in the ankle of the pitcher's foot. He's rolling sideways, like literally falling in onto the ankle rather than using the bones of the foot. So let's say you've got the ankle's not working, the foot's not working. He pulls his leg up because he's throwing across the body and there's no room for the leg to work. If that foot doesn't put pressure down, stay there long enough to turn the leg and then the pelvis, you're not going to have a pelvis that squares up. And this is something that I recommend that anyone listening to this actually does. Just get yourself into a stride foot contact position and see the importance of that back leg and the back foot allowing the leg to help with the turning. So looking at the pitcher, if he is not squared up to the plate, it has to be one of two things. Usually 99% of the time, he is either not using his rear leg correctly, his front leg is jamming up the way the hips can turn, or both. And then you're going to have a pitcher that's not square. So in season, this is one of the simplest things to see. It's one of the simplest things to correct. And what you will see when you correct the lower body is the upper body will just easily start to come into the correct position for throwing the ball. Now, does that make sense, Larry?
Yeah, it's so much easier to move. It's just from doing it, you know, feeling it, throwing across your body, so to speak, or you're having poor direction, or having that good direction, and allows that your backside, your throwing side to just, it's a much easier move. And I think when you get the kids out there and they do it, and then they get to feel it, it's like, wow, you know, it's a pretty good moment to have. But I see it a lot. A great, great, great majority of just pitchers in general, I think, don't have the best direction in the world. But like you said, if you practice something enough, you can get pretty good at it. It's just not, it may not be very efficient or the most efficient way, but boy, it's really, I think the guys with the best command usually have the best direction. Command meaning, you know, control being he throws strikes. Well, command meaning he hits the glove, you know, the glove's held up and he can hit the glove. I think the guys with the best command have the best direction, so to speak, or the best components of the stride.
Yes. And what I said, if this were a show on the stride, we'd be talking about, well, why does the pitcher's foot go too far to one side? Or, you know, why, you know, or when he sweeps with his leg, does that cause the problem? What we're talking about right here is simple troubleshooting that even if he's using his stride incorrectly, let's say he's throwing across the body issue, which always has to do with the way he's coming off the back leg. He didn't complete the turn of the front leg. And so there's a lot of reasons for it. But the simplest solution, because we are in season, is that you give that pitcher with that specific error a visual cue as to where he needs to put the foot. You tell him to trust his eye-hand coordination, which he has at a very high level, and that he learns to put the foot a little bit to the left. Now, you're going to do this when you see the pitcher who's throwing across his body and now all of a sudden having trouble, or a pitcher that you need and he has trouble, and you see that this is it. That the solution that I gave you, or what to look for, is the simplest way to start to address it. As it gets more difficult, you have to understand the reason for the problem. But we have to deal with simple things in season, and we pray that the simple thing works. And if it doesn't, shoot me an email. You go to the next level. But changing a stride is critical, but understanding some of the features of it can help you make quick fixes that are in season. And trust me, the pitcher feels all tied up anyway. In fact, he'll say to you he feels locked up. He'll say he feels tied up. And when he does it correctly, he'll say, wow, that's better. And then he will be motivated to start to make that correction. And that's the best you can hope for in season. And then you just put that on the little clipboard and you say, this is what we're working on in his next pen, or when we have a break, or off season, or whatever seems appropriate. So, and now the second thing that, and this is one of the things, if you start to have a pitcher go bad, you need to have, you know, when pitchers call me, I'm not on the field with them. And so the first thing I have to do is do a very thorough interview. And I've had really good pitchers have some great outings, but they didn't feel they performed well. And then I've had pitchers call me where they're pitching and then their arm's starting to hurt. And I have to ask very in-depth questions. Pitchers will give you all the clues as to what's really went on with them in that last outing. And one of the most frequent things that I hear from pitchers after an outing, when, and these may be my guys or they may be new people that are calling me, and I'll say, well, tell me, how did everything feel? And the most frequent thing I hear is my timing was off. And once you hear that a pitcher thinks his timing is off, you, and I can't always investigate because I may not be seeing enough film, he may not have film, but if a pitcher feels his timing is off, you want to treat this like a computer that needs to be rebooted. And let's say you're able to see where the timing's off. Let's say, for example, you saw the first error. He's all locked up in his hips because he's throwing across his body. And oh my gosh, that's causing his arms to be late or whatever you might see. Well, go ahead and deal always with the lower body first and then see if that changes the timing. If you see a specific timing problem, go ahead and work with that. But let's say you're trying to work with it and what you are doing isn't working. Or let's say you can't see anything because maybe you don't film. Maybe you film, but you don't know how to look at the details of timing. So what are you going to do? It's like you're sitting with your computer. You're in the middle of a project. It blows up. It does something weird. What's the first thing an IT guy is going to tell you to do? What is, Comcast even tells you to do this. Turn it off, unplug it, plug it back in. And you're like, oh, wow, that's amazing. Wow. So this is what you want. You need to have a rebooting technique. And even if a pitcher is not having trouble, but you look at him one day playing catch or he's in a pen and you're like, he's off today. And maybe he's off mentally. You know, he is a human. Maybe he's off emotionally. He is a human. And the more he's off there and the more it throws his pitching off, the worse his pitching is going to get. So sometimes you have to reboot the pitcher, not just his electrical system, which is what I call timing. So the simplest thing to do for anybody that's having a timing issue, and this works so frequently, I can't tell you, even if they're in the middle of the bullpen and they start going crazy. Or let's say you've given them an adjustment and they're frustrated with it. And then you start seeing him come unglued. And then he starts trying hard. You move the pitcher off the mound. You get him on flat ground. And you do, and I've talked about this before, it's a great tool that everyone has to have in their toolbox. You have to do what I call jumping jack pitching. And this is where, and I always talk about the jumping jack, because the jumping jack proves the evidence of how cool our system is and how sometimes when we learn things, they just don't unlearn, that the body has a way of synchronizing its legs and arms. So in a, I don't care how old the kid is, even if he is starting it and maybe the first three he doesn't do right, but before you know it, he's going to be, arms are going to come out at the same time as the legs. So a half jack is when the arms don't go up over the head. They come up to the shoulder height. And if you do that, that's timing. That's the exact timing of the way we want the arms and legs to move in pitching. They are synchronized. It's a natural wiring. It's innate. So you might as well use it. So what I have my guys do when they're flustered, messed up, timing's off, whatever, I reboot them. All you do is have them stand up sideways to the person that's going to catch them. They're flat ground. The catcher's up. He can be up, down, doesn't matter. And the pitcher's just standing with his arms at his side. So his palms will face into his body. So the back of his hands are facing outward, just like, you know, just natural the way our arms hang at the side. His feet are underneath him. So he's standing like a little pole. His feet are right next to each other. His arms are hanging down. And then you tell him just step and throw. And he is still stepping, turning out. He's not knee lifting. Don't call it a slide step, because in their head, a slide step may have certain nuances to it. Guys call all kinds of things slide steps. They call something with a knee lift a slide step, and it doesn't even look like a slide step. So don't use terminology, and just tell them to step out, arms, legs, same time, like they're doing a jumping jack, and throw the ball. And when they start throwing like that, I have my guys throw flat ground like that. I have them get on the mound like that. I have the catcher be down like that. And after they've done that for, like, let's say, you know, the body learns, nervous system changes in 20 repetitions. So let's say you throw them down on the ground, flat ground, seven, give me seven, get on the mound, same thing, catcher's up. Okay, catcher's down, same thing. And before you know it, they're smooth, they're running easily, they're smiling, they've shaken off the timing problem, and that's how you get a pitcher rebooted in season when you don't have time to, like, dig deep. You just need to fix it.
Good stuff. I need to use that. We've used it a little bit in the past in regards to the front arm and front leg, but I don't think I've ever really heard you explain it in that detail. It's pretty simple, really simple concept, but gosh, how... It's the beauty of genius, right? And the simplicity of it.
Yeah, the beauty of simplicity. Hey, and also the beauty of that 6 weeks off I had.
That's right. You needed it, didn't you?
I needed it. I think I came back just a little bit smarter. I don't know, more relaxed, something. But yeah, keeping it simple is the name of the game in season. Pitchers call me, or fathers call me, especially, and want me to work with pitchers. Like, my son needs help, blah, blah, blah. But there's only so much you can do, because if you try to change too much, you do damage. And the most important thing is not to do damage. We have to remember there's a human being inside who's got a lot of pressure on him. And we've got to respect that, and we have to work around that. You always work around the pitcher's psyche, and that's how you make things happen. And that's how we keep these guys in the game. So anyway, what do you think about all that?
It's good stuff. Good. No, it's relative to what, you know, what we do, or what I'm doing, or guys like me do. You know, you have arms, you have pitchers that maybe aren't, you know, pitching like they're capable. So then you have to ask yourself, you know, well, why is it? Is it just purely mechanical? Is it mechanical because he's hurt and doesn't want to tell you? Or is it, you know, then there's, and we've talked about it at great length, but like mental, is it something that, you know, that's affecting his performance? So that's, you know, troubleshooting, trying to find out, you know, why a pitcher isn't executing pitches. I mean, you know, he just needs experience. Maybe he just needs to pitch. Maybe he just needs to continue to work at it. But guys that you're expecting a lot out of, I think that's the trick. Is it purely mechanical? Are they hurt, and which has caused the mechanical deficiency, or, you know, is it just something mental that's going on with them? So it's a tough thing.
Exactly. And yeah. And then trying to, you know, we pinpoint details when we have the opportunity to do that. But the reason why I brought up these two things is simple. If a pitcher's job is to hit a target, and his body's supposed to be facing the target, the first thing you look at is the body facing the target. Okay. So that's that part. The other part is there's a timing to pitching because the arms and legs have got to work together. And if they don't work together, your pitches will come out of your hand in a different way. If you're always doing the same thing, I mean, do any movement that you want to do when you're done on this podcast. I don't care if you want to lift your arm up and down 20 times or lift it to the side 20 times or kick your foot out 20 times. If you are standing in the same place, in the same shape, maybe hanging on so you don't lose your balance, and you do that movement, it's going to go the same way each time because that's the way the joints work. Once you start to do a movement, the brain takes the message from the joint action and it fires the muscles for that action. That's why I work with the bones underneath the muscle first. That's what I see. I actually see the bones of a pitcher. And no, I don't see dead people. I only see the bones of a pitcher when he's moving. And then I know the muscles that are crossing the joint are moving in the direction that the brain is telling. So if you have someone who's off, if he's off, if his hand, if he's not tunneling his pitches, he did something to change something in that process. And this is the same as driving. You're driving down the streets and you're totally straight. Isn't it amazing that we're in maybe a 6-lane highway and everyone's driving straight and we're trusting that. But if somebody comes out of the lane, they turned their wheel to come out of that lane. But if you don't change anything, so they change something. They change something they were doing. And that's the same way the body works. So that's what we all call consistency. And you're more consistent when you're more efficient because that's actually the way your body's designed. So your shoulder's designed to accelerate forward in a certain position. You change that shoulder position a little, it's not going to accelerate forward the same way. So my job is to work with the body and the way it does things and then try to get the pitcher to be efficient. So when we are working with trying to keep it simple, is he facing his target? The other thing is, is his timing correct? Because no matter what error he's making, he's yelling at himself and that throws off the timing. So you get the timing rebooted, which is really rebooting the human. And then you look at the shape that he looks at when he throws the ball. Follow the ball, follow the shape, and that will explain everything you need to see. And that's how you get these quick fixes. Hey, Larry, do you have any question on anything that's come up for you?
We're dealing with it with some of our guys right now, and I've been trying to troubleshoot and, you know, improve their timing. So it's not easy. You wonder if you're climbing up the, you know, right tree, so to speak. You wonder if you're attacking it correctly. And so that's what I've been dealing with a lot lately is timing. So I don't really have a specific question about it. It's just, I mean, you know, it's a combination of a lot of things. Number one, when they're throwing from the set, they're trying to get the ball to home plate pretty quick. So I think that's affecting some of their timing, you know, in our case, you know, with some of our guys. And so I can imagine it happening, maybe not for the same reasons, but just due to inconsistency with younger pitchers, the youth pitcher, for example. I mean, you trying to build some sort of consistency with them so that they do have good timing, so that their arm does arrive at the same spot, hopefully about the same time in the same way. And I think that's maybe somewhat difficult for, you know, the dad who's an accountant and coaching a little league team and trying to help a kid. I think sometimes those things are difficult for them to see. Timing issues. How do you address them? How do you see them? What are you looking for? For me, one thing, maybe my question would be, if I'm a little league coach, I think this is good information for me to know. You know, when do you start moving forward? You know, when do you do it? Throwing from the set, having to hold runners maybe, or just maybe he's a 10-year-old and doesn't. He's not holding runners yet, but he's pitching from the set or the stretch. It's the same thing. You know, when do you move forward? When do you initiate that? Is it everybody's leg kick is a different height? And then sometimes they do it in different ways. And some, I don't know if I'm getting ahead of you or anything, but I don't know. How do you address that? How do you see it?
It's a great question. And it actually ties in with something I already talked about. So first of all, especially with young pitchers. So with our guys that are already developed, I'm very sensitive about looking at how they work from the stretch and from the windup. Okay. And all you coaches, we know that you're always, you know, making sure he's to the plate fast enough, this and that. But if you got a pitcher that's having trouble with one or another, especially coming from the stretch where he doesn't seem like he's moving right or quick enough, or you see him hesitating too much. I saw a pitcher the other day and I asked him to send me film of each one. And it's like, I'm like, you can't be fast enough to the plate. He says, oh yeah, no, I'm under 1.3 or whatever. I'm like, no, this can't be right. And because my eye, if I'm seeing him hovering, you know what I mean? The leg comes up and he's I'm on my balance leg now. I'm like, no, you know, but here's the thing about, especially when you're teaching kids, first of all, movements are pretty innate. We kind of know when to go forward. We kind of know when to do things. You have to allow that to emerge. But no youth pitcher should be taught how to pitch from the stretch with the runner on base with anything other than a slide step, which is kind of like the jumping jack drill. And when I say it's slide step, I mean the foot just goes out. Now, I practice this all the time because, you know, I'm a hip lower body person. That's my whole thesis was on that. And I'm always investigating, you know, how do you make this happen? First of all, whenever you're talking about timing coming from the stretch or something that looks wrong, if the pitcher doesn't understand that the side of the hip. So when you put your hands on your waistline, like you're about to yell at somebody, so you're take your right hand, your left hand, whichever is dominant, drop the other one down so you can feel this. Right there where your hand is right on the side, it would be like if you're doing a side bend or something. I want you to picture a muscle on the side of your body going down towards your legs. Let's say you have a pair of sweatpants on that have a stripe on the side. Your hand, put it right on the part of the stripe that is right on your pelvis, not in the front, not in the back. We're going to talk about it on the side. And even though for all the kinesiologists out there, I do know the fibers spread in a different direction, but for teaching purposes, pretend it's right on the side. That is the muscle that leads the body out. The foot cannot do it. The foot cannot do it. It cannot do it. It cannot do it. The foot is the support, so you can move that hip out, but that hip has to move you out. Where your weight is on your feet is going to make that movement from the hip easier or more difficult. But if your weight is on that hip, you can lift the leg forward faster. So you always teach appropriate weight placement whenever you're teaching going sideways, which, as I said, is the first part of the movement. Now, in life, we do not move sideways. Okay. By the way, in 2023, the new Hummer is going to be able to move sideways. That is so scary to me. No, listen, when I heard that as an analytical kinesiologist, I'm like, first, I'm going to have to stop using cars as my analogies because I'm always talking about they go forward, the wheels go forward. The 2023 Hummer is going to have an ability for all the tires to turn so it moves sideways. Don't ask me why in this era of all drugs are legal that we're going to want people to be able to move sideways on the street. Oh, I'm like, there go my analogies. But for right now, in 2021, we don't do anything sideways except in like when, you know, some sports we move sideways, but in life in general, we don't shuffle sideways to get anywhere. But in sports, it is sideways. So teaching weight shift is probably people don't get this. They don't get it because in life, we don't do it. You have to learn it when you play any sport, basketball, tennis, golf, pitching, hitting, because it's a sideways movement. And because we're not in touch with the muscles in the middle, and plus it's counterintuitive. Wouldn't you think if you're moving sideways, your feet are what's moving you sideways? No. Wouldn't you think if you're moving sideways downhill, your foot leg that's leading is pulling you downhill? No, it's not. The hip is pulling you sideways, is pushing you sideways. So you put all the weight in that leg. That's what we do when we lift the front leg. We weight shift into the back leg. That is to give the back leg more weight and power so that muscle can move us forward. Now, if you don't connect with that, you're not going to know it. So you have to teach that. You just put the hand on the kid. You don't have to go into details and say, move from here. They'll move from there. And then they'll learn if they're in the back leg, their front leg moves out easily. As they develop, they will find their own personal characteristic based on their body type, based on strength and everything else. They'll know exactly how much weight to put on that back foot, how much to be on the front. But if you see someone caught in the middle and they can't get that front leg to move because they have to move backwards first, that's where you start to play around with how far their feet might be when they come set. It's how much weight they should have on each leg, but it is a very personal thing. But if a pitcher's trying to move from his foot, he's going to do that. And what will end up trying to move him is his knee. And the knee does not move sideways, but it can turn sideways if you turn the foot. And then you end up with this back leg that's doing all these other things because the hip didn't move correctly. So the first thing you do is you teach that. It's very simple. The person will feel it, and that's how you do it. But when you're working with kids, get the knee lift out of the mix, because other than the glove arm, the knee lift gets most pitchers in trouble. Every mechanical change I've ever had to make, 70-80%, it's glove arm or knee lift related, doing something crazy with those body parts that you might think have nothing to do with the pitch itself, but they have everything to do with the pitch. So that's a good way. And that was a great question, Larry. When you're dealing with kids, keep it simple. Teach them how to move sideways. If you think of the stride as that, moving sideways, then you will have the game handled by like 75%.
Yeah, that's good. I think one of the most important things, you know, in dealing with this that you've talked about, I think what's really, really relevant and sticks out to me is, you know, you have to get in your back leg, so to speak, or your weight should be most of your weight, if not all of your weight, depending on what you're doing. If you're just beginning to learn how to move that way, get your weight on your back leg. I think I see a lot of guys come set in games with their weight evenly distributed. And I think it affects their command. I think it affects timing. I think it affects a lot of different things. So I think that's a really good way to teach it. You know, especially, if I'm a youth coach, heck yeah. That's pitching to me is like a glorified form of play. It's a more intense form of playing catch. So you better be able to play catch first. You're going to kind of crank up the intensity and then expect to throw the ball where you want to. I think that's a really good way to teach it. That's really good. It's good stuff.
So when you see a guy that has his legs far apart in the set, and you see that his foot doesn't do a knee lift, he does kind of get the foot out there quickly. The timing problem of that, because that might be very efficient. In fact, we were talking about this morning when we got off the phone. I came set in about 5 different ways to see how would I do it. And I was able to figure it out and move fast in most all the positions. But guess what the problem is? Let's say you have a wonderful, for this guy, let's say you're not looking at his upper body and he's coming set and he moves and you see his foot going out. What is the problem for that pitcher? His arms might be late because maybe he doesn't move his arms as fast enough. So you can't always isolate just the legs, because what are we looking at? Legs and arms have got to work together, because no matter what position you're coming from, I don't care if it's the windup, I don't care if it's the stretch, I don't care if you're using a slide step, I don't care if you're shuffling, doing one of these crazy drills, the arm position of the pitching arm has got to be exactly timed with when the front foot makes contact, not when it's flat, when it makes contact, when it denotes the end of that stride phase. And if you're really fast on the lower body, which, you know, if you're seeing a timing issue or what you're thinking is timing from the stretch, what you might be seeing is that the two parts aren't working together. Not so much that the lower body's off, because, you know, we're in balance all the time. And if the pitcher is in his head saying, I got to get my foot out fast, which is what he is saying, and that is what he needs to do, pretty much he's going to have his body weight placed where it would be given his height and his length of his legs, how much he weighs. But where the error would come in isn't so much at changing that. It's at, are his arms moving as fast? So let's say you've got a guy who goes, let's pretend he's going way up over his head like pitchers do on the windup. Let's say he would do that from the stretch, but he's got a real fast slide step. Well, you would see a problem in timing. Let's say he has the glove up high and he's lowering it the same way he does from the windup, but he's got a different stride. So if you don't see adjustments on both ends, that could be the timing thing. Here's what is a great fix for this, or this is your investigation tool. So let's talk about this as another way to investigate, which is what today's show is about, giving you some simple things. Have the pitcher get on the mound and have him get rid of his glove, get rid of the any accessory like that, and put his have him hug himself. No, he doesn't need a ball. Have him hug himself. And have him be, so he's got his arms wrapped around him, and then you have him come set, and then you have him pitch. And now he's not going to open his arms up. All you're going to see is a stride, and you're going to see rotation of the trunk. But he's not going to have the arms working. And then you see, how did he do it? You say, okay, pretend you're from the stretch, come set. Now go. See what he does. And let him be where he comes. Where he comes is where he's comfortable. That's his body weight. And see what he does. Now, whatever timing your eye catches, say, okay, now add your arms. And my guess is you'll go, whoa, it's his arms. They're way too slow. So what does that mean? Well, you have to figure out how can we time this, or he might have to change the way he slide steps or the way he does whatever he does when he's from the stretch. And this is also for the coach to do based on, well, first of all, is he getting to the plate fast enough? What he needs to be under, needs to be 1-3 to the plate?
Yeah, he needs to be about one, between 1-3, 1-4 is pretty acceptable, but better 1-3 is the quicker the better. 1-3 is pretty good.
Okay. So if he's 1-3, but something's going on, you don't want to change that timing. So it may be the upper body. And again, you can have him put his arms at his side so he's not coming out of the glove and have him still come set in the same way and then have him come up and throw. That way you're finding out, is the problem with the speed at which he raises his arm up? That's what that would show, with his arms hanging at the side. Or let's say you didn't see any timing difference, but then you know, okay, it's the way he's separating his hands, or where's the glove at? A lot of guys, when they're thinking about moving fast with their legs, their upper body kind of goes into a freeze mode. In other words, they may be keeping the ball in the glove. So my pitcher that I saw that was having a big difference from the stretch and windup, his knee's moving down and his leg's moving forward and the glove hasn't gone anywhere. I still don't see the ball. Now, he didn't know it. But see, he's in his head going, I got to get to the plate. Got to run around second. Run. Something slows down sometimes. And this is in life we do this. When we get jolted or we get scared or whatever, something might move fast and something might move slow. You get clumsy. And a lot of times it's your arms, because our arms flail more than our hips do. So his lower body. So you look at, and by having him start with no arms, then arms at the side, and then you watch his glove. Because if you identify, it's his timing coming out of the glove. He gets up to 90 degrees perfectly with this set point on from the stretch. So the error has to be with the way he lowers the glove and comes out. And it may be that if he's perfect in every way, you might have to make an adjustment at that. You can't have the same upper body motion completely if your legs are moving faster. And when I say that, I don't mean they have to do something differently. They maybe have to just move differently at a different speed. Or maybe he's doing something different and it's not good, like he's getting stuck. Because he feels like he's going down the plate, down the mound so fast that he kind of is hanging on to his hands. You know what I'm saying? So these are ways to investigate. So there you go. So Larry, just so the audience knows, Larry and I went around a big circle on this topic this morning, which I did not have this idea until after I got off the phone. So I have a little delayed response sometimes, but it's such a good topic. I wanted to revisit it because the stretch is, hey, you. When I ask a pitcher, where are you best at? He says, from the windup. I said, that's too bad. That's too bad. I said, I want to hear both are good. But yeah, to diminish the importance of pitching from the stretch is like missing the whole point, you know, of baseball.
The most important pitches of your life will be thrown from the set. You better get good at it and you better get used to it.
Exactly. Unless you're pitching against a team that can't hit at all, in which case, oh, well.
Well, the reason being, obviously, is because in most cases, you know, obviously, you're thrown from the set because runners are on base. And if runners are on base, those are potential runs. So you see a lot of guys that'll, you know, they'll get to a third base, second and third, or bases loaded and want to throw from the windup. And, you know, because I feel more comfortable. Well, you better get pretty comfortable throwing from the set because those are potential runs out there. And if you're not comfortable, then you better figure out a way to be comfortable. And so it's huge. It's important. It's really important. And they have a lot on their plate because, you know, especially when stealing bases becomes pretty prominent in high school and college, I mean, then they got to be quick to the plate and now they're trying to rush and it creates, it can be a big mess. And so it's really important. I think you've given some really good insight in regards to how to work on it and how to address, you know, inconsistencies in being able to throw strikes. And then of course, I think there's still some great info there for them to be able to get the ball to home plate in a timely fashion and command it.
Exactly. Yeah. And I thought these topics today, I love them. Actually, the show is really, I thought was an interesting show. And so if I've sparked any thought or questions or anything on any of the listeners, I hope you're all going to be going out trying some of this stuff. But if you have any further questions on these topics, please email me and let me know what they are because I can revisit it in the next podcast, which will not be 6 weeks from today, I promise. God, I know. I want to do one every 2 weeks. I'm going to commit to that. 2 weeks. I'll see everybody, okay? I promise. I am a good Catholic girl, so I am not going to lie. So anyway, thank you so much for being with me today. So if you have any questions on anything you heard today or you want to contact me, angel@jimscience.com. You can go to my website, jimscience.com. You can hear this on YouTube, iTunes, and any other way that you can think of to get a podcast. And please join me again in 2 weeks for another great show. And thank you all for listening. And hey, thanks everybody for all the calls and emails that came during my little hiatus. So, okay, I'll see all of you soon. Bye-bye.